All right, we can get started. This will be the 1.5 episode, everybody that was trying to do this before. In light of all the activity that's going on with Facebook and Google Plus, as well as other social media stuff this week, I thought we'd make that the topic of conversation today. For everybody that's watching live but not in here and doesn't know what the heck is going on, basically Google Plus just allows us to allows 10 people to get into a group and have a discussion, and then we're broadcasting that live as well and recording it, so hopefully we'll be able to put this up later for people to watch later. I thought that the way we would start is the way we did last week and just go left to right. We might have some people popping in here as the chat goes on, but Bill, you want to introduce yourself?
Hey, good morning again, everyone. Bill Brown from Heartfelt National, Avondale, Pennsylvania, outside Philadelphia. Really been enjoying these Google Plus Hangouts. Last week was a success for the Hangout, the people that were listening live, and looking forward to continuing these.
Good morning as well. Bob Porter from Hiawatha Golf Course in Minneapolis, Minnesota, and enjoying these.
My name is Greg Schaefer. I'm from Elkona Country Club in northern Indiana over in Notre Dame country. And this is all not really a new experience for me, but I'm really enjoying the conversations that we've had, and I think this will continue to be a positive thing.
Hey guys, my name is Jason Cruz. I'm an assistant professor at the University of Florida down in Gainesville, and I just been following and saw John had this coming up and thought I'd join in with you guys.
Jason, are you here?
Yeah. Oh, he's in
the other Jason. That was Jason.
I didn't see the next guy was Jason.
Jason's mic might not be working, so I'll introduce myself. I'm John Kaminsky. I'm an assistant professor at Penn State, and started the Turf Disease website with a few other people, and that's kind of where we're going with these hangouts. So hopefully we can keep this going on a weekly basis. Larry.
I'm Larry Stoll from Pace Turf out in San Diego. How about it, John?
Okay, I've been so busy playing with all the new social media stuff, in particular the Facebook timeline that came out yesterday, and I activated it on my account today, and so I haven't had time to really plan for this, and that's probably what we should have been doing, but I guess I would like to start with some of the superintendents that are in the room and find out how they're using social media, whether it be blogs or Facebook or whatever. We've had some discussion with the posts that I put up this week on the Turf Disease page, where some people are, you know, going to continue to be anti-social media and it's a waste of time and all of those things. And so maybe, Bill, you can start. You're really involved with it. How do you see it benefiting you from a superintendent standpoint?
You know, I can remember, 8 years ago as an assistant when you know, we needed to communicate with people. Like Greg and I were talking before we went live this morning about, you know, when my snow mold app goes down, and we were talking about grubs. And prior to social media, that communication was kind of restricted, or was, you know, with the guy, you know, 5 miles down the road from you, or, you know, maybe it was a buddy you went to college with that was in New Jersey. But now with social media, particularly Twitter, you know, I'll use Bob Porter and I as an example. Bob and I met at the GIS show 2 years ago, and we talk, she's 10 times a week through some social media platform. We've been talking about grubs most of this week, as most of us are, but it's really expanded your ability to communicate with a larger network on a more frequent basis. It's really given me a lot of ideas and some ways to set my shop up. I was talking to a gentleman on Twitter about my job board in the morning. I changed my job board around a little bit. So it has really given us some ideas. And anybody who says it's a waste of time, I think they're crazy. It's a little difficult to show a little return on investment sometimes because it's tough to narrow down some of those costs you might save or some of the opportunities you gain. But it's a huge benefit for us, and it really needs to be shown in this industry. I think the demographics of our industry, I know Larry, you had brought that up through some posts on Google Plus. I think the issue with social media in our industry is I think the demographics of our industry is a little bit older, and I don't want to say anti-technology, but just not a little more old school. And I think as some of these younger assistants get in, and guys like John, and forgive me, Jason, I'm not familiar with your curriculum, but I know John is a big social media user, and I know when his students get in there, I'm sure they will be as well. So I think, you know, in a few years, the demographics will be the same, but I think more people start using the Twitter and the blogs and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, I think to kind of mimic what Bill said, it's become a great tool. You know, I think when I first got on it on Twitter, at least, it was kind of to see what was going on or what other guys were saying. But now it's become so much more of a peer-to-peer thing, at least in the turf groups anyway, to bounce ideas off one another and find out what's going on around the country. And like Bill said, I'm spraying for grubs right now, and I know he is, and many others as well. So you find out what people are spraying, what people are having good luck with. But I think also the issues that we've had with weather and here, and I know out east, the heat and humidity and turf death, and I think it's at least for me anyway, it's been a great sounding board. I think so many times as superintendents anyway, we feel like we're sitting out on an island, even though there's, you know, hundreds of golf courses, but you're not necessarily always communicating with those around you. But to hear other stories and what other people are doing, and to kind of pick you up, I guess, so to speak, when you're feeling really like there's nothing going right. So I, this year at least for sure, it's been a huge thing for me to be able to communicate with other guys and find out what's going on, and you know, feel like you're not the only one going through this. So it's been a great thing. I'm at a public facility, but we have many men's club members and some of the league players that follow me on Twitter, I know, and my blog, I probably haven't kept up on it as well as I should. I'm kind of redoing it right now, and that's probably hurt me a little bit. I used to update fairly regularly, and then with all of the issues going on this year, kind of went away from it a little bit, probably just didn't want to rehash all the things that were going on, but in hindsight, I probably should have kept up on and kept more of them informed. So in that sense, it kind of bit me, but it's going to be good going forward. So,
yeah, I think one of the primary uses that all of you as superintendents have been using social media, aside from Facebook and all of that, is the use of the blogs. And those have been pretty good, and they've kind of exploded. I was reading a post by somebody the other day who said they've been, maybe it was Chris Chertabaugh, saying that he'd been posting for since 2007. And you've just seen an explosion of blogs in the last probably year and a half. I think GIS last year, where they really tried to highlight and showcase some of the use of social media, that kind of helped it out. And places like Golf Course Industry, when you go there and you see the super blog section, you can see all the different blogs that superintendents are using. But Bob, you make a good point. If you don't keep up with it, then it becomes pretty stale, and then it's like, well, yeah, you know, what am I using it for? And I think the last time we talked, some of you were saying how that staleness had members complaining to you about, well, how come the blog's not updated, and how come you're not posting things for us to see? So, Greg, what about you?
Yeah, I agree 100%. Specifically speaking about blogs, that is it's been a relatively new thing for me this year. During a tough season like we've all had, have found that has been a tremendous asset in getting correct information out there, as opposed to members thinking they know the answers and telling other people probably some incorrect information. Just having another platform out there to spread the word about any issues that we have going on. And, you know, again, going back to what everybody else has said, you know, this social media thing not only has been a tremendous tool, either whether it's through Facebook or Twitter or Google Plus or these Hangouts or, you know, whatever specific thing you want to reference, I think it's just a fantastic communication tool for us as superintendents and as turf professionals to be able to network whether it's just having personal conversations or talking about what's going on a daily basis on the golf course or who's trying what's working, what isn't working. You know, I saw on a post that Chris Trinabaugh made earlier this week, I think, on Google Plus. He was saying that, you know, as an individual, he's not really comfortable getting out there and introducing himself and introducing himself to other people and being forward and sort of things like that. I'm pretty much the same way, but having this as a forum to be able to talk to other guys and really communicate on a whole different level, it's really good for me to know that, you know, this year when we go to the GIS show, I can go up to any of these guys and be able to sit down and have a conversation, even though we've never met face to face, whether it's, you know, doing this through the Hangouts or via Twitter at 140 characters at a time. If you do it long enough, you kind of get to know some of these guys, and just one more person you can talk to when you've got issues and bounce some things off of.
Sorry, I'm adjusting. Every time somebody comes in, it changes the size of it, and so I have to kind of keep adjusting this. Nadim, you came in. I muted you because there was a lot of feedback. So if you're trying to talk and we can't hear you, you're muted. But you can unmute yourself if you want. Larry, from your perspective, I know you have a pretty good presence on Facebook, and obviously your website is great. And you've done some things to try and increase traffic, you know, like iPad giveaway. And I guess my question is, and you mentioned this in the Google chat room, you know, well, how do you get followers, and you're doing the iPad giveaway and you weren't seeing a big response in terms of, like, you know, a huge influx of people. But I guess my question becomes, is it really about, you know, numbers, or is it about, you know, having quality people that are following your page and doing things? I don't know. We talked about this with the super blogs, and maybe you only need to get the 10 most important people reading it as opposed to every superintendent in the country. It's overwhelming if you try and keep up with it all. But if you get your target audience reading it, then that's probably the most important. But what about you, Larry, in terms of what are your thoughts on it?
Yeah, well, I think there's a few opportunities with the whole social media and the type of video conferencing that we're doing right now, or this video hangout type stuff, because I think there's a lot of guys out there that don't type well or are uncomfortable typing, and that sort of restricts you to communications, not necessarily that require typing input. So those guys could participate via the video end of things, and also the asynchronous side. Some people just don't want to participate, but recordings like the one you're doing now, John, can be rebroadcast, and that's a handy thing. As far as on our side, because we're a site that's an information site, and we're trying to get subscribers, so we just like a lot of people, which would be good. But we also had a problem with some of the we have a membership service, and some of the guys on the membership service with the iPad 2 giveaway wanted to make sure that they're included in the drawing, even if they don't like the Facebook page, because they've got either a security restriction from the company that they are in working for, or they're uncomfortable with the security issues associated with the social networking site. So there's necessarily a limited subset of the whole universe of superintendents and associated people out there that are going to work in the social networking side. So it's kind of hard to how to best utilize it. But I think when you capture this information and you put it up onto turf diseases, then you bring the stuff from the social side. Even if people can't participate, they're going to be able to take advantage of it. So people are going to like social media, even if they're not participating, because they're going to be receiving the benefits, I think, with projects like what you're doing right now.
Right. And this is just one example of the use of social media. I think Google, obviously there's been this huge kind of battle going on, especially this week, but in the last few months with Google launching their Google Plus. If somebody's watching the live stream on here, I don't know who is, but I hear some feedback, so I'm gonna mute some people and see if that clears it up. So anyway, I think that the competition in live stream, not live stream, but Google Plus and Facebook and all of these things that are coming out, and particularly, you know, the ability to do something like this, to have this hangout, will ultimately bring some of those naysayers into it. I will say, though, and when I give talks, you know, one of the things I say is when I signed up for Facebook, you know, immediately one of my friends started from high school started instant messaging me, and I was like, I'm like, delete. I do not want to be having this conversation. And then you kind of learn how to use it, but it can be a huge waste of time if you don't learn to manage it for what you want. So, Jason Cruz, are you involved in much of the social media with your work? Are you doing a lot of things?
I've been getting into it a little bit, John. It's been interesting. There's Brian Unruh and I here at the University of Florida have been trying to get a presence on Facebook. I have mixed presence off and on Twitter. I think I'm the only faculty member here in TURF that's doing that right now. And then, you know, trying to engage the students a little bit on, you know, through Facebook to some extent as a way of keeping in contact with both current students and some of our recent alumni. One of the things that, you know, speaking about this kind of this resistance to jumping in and using it, I had a student on an internship this summer that had used Facebook probably inappropriately, but used it on a computer at the golf course and ended up getting a virus and crashing their irrigation computer. And, you know, that when that happens, it's not going to lend itself to having people welcome the presence of something like that in the work environment. You know, that unfortunately resulted in him losing his internship over the summer. And I don't question the superintendent for the decision, because it had been made clear after several discussions that, you know, he wasn't supposed to use that particular computer for anything. So, but when, you know, the fact that happened and the fact that it happened through Facebook, I think is, you know, having that vulnerability there is going to make people resistant to doing stuff at work. And then, you know, like your discussion about the things that came up on chat or instant messaging, there's stuff that pops up that you, to some extent, have no control over, and you don't want to put yourself at risk for, you know, being accused of viewing the wrong thing at work. So,
right, and the, you know, the virus coming in through Facebook is unfortunate, but that could happen through any system. You know,
exactly. It could have been, and the fact that it was this student in this instance, he was not the only one using that computer for that type of thing. It just was an unfortunate chain of events. So,
right.
John, yes. That might be a really valuable a piece of information to put on with this video, maybe, is that what some security guidelines to encourage people to get on. Because that's the feedback I'm getting from some of our clients, is that they just don't want to deal with the potential security issues. I don't know how you can protect them all, you know, other than give everybody an iPad or something.
Well, the risk in this case... Yeah, the computer didn't have any virus protection on it. Ultimately, is what it probably could have been solved by a simple virus protection, and they hadn't made that investment. So,
I should welcome Dr. Fidanza. You there? You got some volume? He must be on a serious delay, or he's frozen. Anyway, oh, there he is. He's moving around a little bit. I don't, maybe he just can't hear us. Or he's pretending to be here. So we've talked about some of the virus issues and people maybe being resistant to it at work. And I think, you know, if you ask people 2 or 3 years ago, it would be most companies, or a lot of them anyway, would probably block Facebook and some of these other sites. Where now, you know, if you look at the College of Agriculture at Penn State, they've embraced it. They have sites that list all of the people that are on Twitter, and there are so many faculty that are doing it. Our dean routinely tweets out messages about what's going on, good and bad. You know, we're hit by the economy just as much as anyone else, and they're combining departments and doing layoffs, and he doesn't hide behind that. He doesn't show only the good stuff. He will also talk about the bad things that are happening, hopefully to inform people. But Facebook and Twitter and blogs, they all kind of get used differently. So how many people in here, I guess you're probably the cutting edge social media people, but and I guess my question is, what are the feelings in terms of the use of social media, Facebook, blogs, Twitter, now Google, and anything else that's out there? Where are superintendents missing the boat or using it effectively? Bill? Craig, go ahead.
Yeah, I was going to say, I think you're kind of getting back to something that you were saying, you know, earlier about looking at, you know, how Penn State uses the media, uses social media. You know, I've had a lot of discussions with, you know, some guys on our board here at the club about doing this sort of thing, whether it's through a hangout like this or using Twitter. And the response that I have received is, oh, I don't understand how all that works. And I, you know, it seems to be a high level of difficulty and they don't understand it. But where they do see the benefit is through promotion of the industry, promotion of the club, and certainly continuing education on my end just through having conversations. And I think if more superintendents could see that or understand that there is a value to doing this. You're not just sitting in your office for an hour having a conversation with guys from around the country, around the world for that matter. You are learning things, and you know, I'm fortunate that my club understands that and they see a value to that and certainly see, you know, potential promotion of the club through that. You know, every time we introduce ourselves, we talk about who we are, where we're from, and they, you know, not really going to help them a whole lot, but they see a name recognition behind that and see some value with that.
Right.
You know, John, I think you preach this a lot.
I preach a lot.
It's something,
yeah,
I need to start doing this year in my talks. It's, you know, guys jump in and you don't feel like you need to have a Twitter account, have a blog, have a Facebook, have a Google, you know, Tumblr, Flickr. Just get comfortable. Just go in, pick one thing that you're comfortable with. Maybe it's just Facebook. You also have to evaluate the time. You know, are you more, if you're in the office, are you more comfortable being on your laptop and communicating? You know, for me, I use Twitter more because I can use it on my phone. You know, and it's not a whole lot of time that it takes up, you know. With some of the notifications on Twitter, specifically on an iPhone, you can set up to be notified if somebody either uses your name, mentions your name, or direct messages you. So for me, Twitter's almost been an extension of a cell phone call. Again, and it's just expanded my network, and it's given me more ideas. So again, to feel like guys that maybe are hesitant to jump in on this, just get started with something. Maybe it's just following these once a week and getting a Google Plus account and just listening to what's going on. Because if you feel like you have to jump in with everything all at once, it's just too much. I mean, I'm sometimes now with the Google Plus, it does at times get a little overwhelming because I feel like I'm behind if I'm not checking something during the day. Like I missed something. I know there's some chat going on the Google Plus. For those of you, John doesn't have it up, but on the left side bar, there's a chat that we're kind of talking behind the scenes here.
I didn't even know that you were talking. I had it on the invite tab.
Greg said, you know, how often do you guys use these hangouts? Well, you know, when I'm on Google Plus, I'll just start a hangout and I'll post it publicly. And there's times John will jump on, Bob will jump on, and it's just, hey, what's going on? How's your day? You know, and it's just, you know, maybe you pick something up, maybe you don't. So, where I think guys are missing the boat is if they don't do anything, because I think there's a huge opportunity cost there. Just as much as we try and communicate to our members the value that goes into attending the GIS show, I think we need to start communicating the value of maybe sitting down on a Friday at 9 o'clock and listening to these, because I think there's a value there, and if you're not using it, you're missing something.
Yeah, I would say that Twitter is the number one platform that I use. It just is the most informative to me to be able to get to a wealth of information. I follow news stories through CNN and Washington Post and all these different news outlets. Obviously, I follow a lot of the golf course people, also some photographers and all kinds of things. It is a quick way to get information. And the number one question I get when I'm giving talks on social media at these meetings and events is, well, how much time do you spend? It's like all you do is social media. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, I really don't spend, I'm always on it. I'm always connected because of the cell phone, but I really don't spend that much time. I'm not there in front of a computer doing stuff all the time. But it does take a little bit of effort to get used to it and figure out where your flow is going to be with it. But it's surprising to me that people still haven't jumped on board Twitter as much as I thought they would have, because to me that's still the best place for me to get information.
John, I think you bring up a good point relative to figuring out what your flow is going to be. The figuring out what your voice is going to be in that online presence is something that I don't know that I've exactly figured it out yet, and I think it takes a little bit of time to be comfortable putting yourself out there, putting stuff, you know, on a permanent record that's going to say, here's how I feel about this situation, or here's the issue I'm dealing with, how do I best address it?
Right. Sorry, I was reading the chat, too. I got a lot of things going on here. I was B&H Photo just announced on Twitter that the D700 was back in stock in limited numbers like 2 minutes before this chat went live. And while we were starting and you're doing your introductions, I'm entering my credit card information to buy the camera. I'm like, I got to get this camera. So, and that I saw on Twitter. You know, they put an announcement up that they are back in stock in limited quantity and they've been out forever. And I immediately saw it, clicked on the link, bought the camera, and now by next week I'm going to have a brand new camera in my house, which I love.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I think that part of the time suck as it's involved in all of the social media platforms is really trying to get into some of the nitty-gritty in terms of how to connect all these things. When we post a blog post on Penn State or turf diseases or whatever, it automatically goes to Twitter, so it's not like we have to be in both places at the same time. So we utilize a lot of the functions that they inherently have built into WordPress or Blogger or whatever it is to push those feeds out. So that helps to save a lot of the time, but it does take a little bit of practice. And you know, most people in here that I've spoken to before know that I have slight issues sleeping at night, and so I end up staying up all night teaching myself how to do some of these things. But you know, once you get the hang of it, then it goes pretty quick.
Hey, yeah, John. I think
go ahead, Bob.
Similar to what everyone has already said, I think there is a big misconception of, you know, it must take you like hours a day or hours a week. And I've given a couple talks. I gave one this summer in Milwaukee, and I think that was probably a vast number of the questions saying, well, you must spend hours a day doing this. Well, no, not really. I mean, part of it is learning the tools, like John said, of how best to use them. But, you know, I know like Chris Tritabaugh, for instance, he uses Facebook pretty much exclusively now. He used to be mostly Twitter, but when he posts a Facebook post, it automatically goes to Twitter. So a lot of these services you can link, or vice versa. If you post a Twitter post, you can link it to posts on Facebook. So, you know, whether you pick one or you have five, then you could, you know, just link them all together and only post at one, and then they all fulfill, you know, it all gets out there. But I think also it was an experience this summer of how many vendors are monitoring these social media sites as well. I think I mentioned this the other day, and I had an issue with a Jacobson triplex and the new electric Eclipse. And actually both of our units were having issues, and I kind of posted on Twitter just to see what would happen, because I knew that Jacobson Turf followed me and I followed them. So I just quickly posted, you know, not very happy with my mowers right now. No one can figure out what's wrong with them. And my vendor called me, local vendor called me and said, I don't know what you did, but we just got 20 calls from anywhere from executives at Jacobson to the plant manager that made the units. Because we have two of, I think, the first dozen or two dozen that came off the line. So within, I think, 30 minutes of when I posted, there was like 20 calls that went out from Jacobson, and the vendor was at my property with a demo unit to get me by. So I was absolutely shocked at that reply or that response. But they are out there monitoring as well. So, you know, for guys that have issues with whether it's irrigation or, because I know Toro follows things like TurfNet and Twitter and things like that, Jacobson, you know, if you have an issue you're not getting response of, it might not hurt to put it out there and, you know, at least make them aware of it and they can act on it.
Right. Bill, did you have a question or something?
Yeah, I am monitoring our Twitter feed here, and on Turf Chat, Tom Margetz, his Twitter handle is at Tom Margetz. He has a question, and I know we've talked about this before on how to do this, but I guess this is for the group, or if John, you want to take it. His question is it appropriate to post the same question, blog marketing info, on all platforms, or is that annoying?
That's a good question. I follow a lot of the people that are so-called social media experts, and I laugh because the people that call themselves experts, the people that are probably really the experts, complain about them. but the consensus seems to be that each platform should be used, you know, in a different way. And you can't ever forget the social aspect. So one of the biggest mistakes I see companies coming in and making, at least from a Twitter standpoint, is that there's no back and forth. It's all just, hey, check out our latest product, check out our latest release, check out this, and it's just a series of updates. And people are like, I'm going to unfollow that or block them. Sorry, I have somebody at my door. So anyway, I think that you have to find the right medium. We tend to post a lot of our stuff in multiple platforms because I think that not everybody uses Twitter, not everybody uses Facebook, not everybody goes to the blogs. So we try to put it everywhere so you get it where you want it. But, you know, that's just how we use it. I don't know what the proper way to do it. Larry, you're, you know, from a side point of having a commercial business, what do you think?
Well, we're trying to figure it out also, to figure out where the value is in the social networking side to get information out. And, of course, our motivation is to try to get people to, you know, support the services we have, which would be what a typical commercial organization would do with the systems. I'm not convinced they're so good for that use, but they're good for getting information out, and I think you do have to put them on, if you have something you want to get out to everybody, you probably do need to use each one of the services independently because different people use the services a different way. But it does get a little bit tedious if you just keep seeing the same posts everywhere you look on the social media sites. But I don't know. And I don't know what the right blend or mix of social media is for superintendents, that which would be just right. Is it just Twitter and Facebook? What sort of has become or will become of TurfNet forums and the GCSAA forums in these sort of roles? They did play a role more in the past from the standard keyboard input kind of systems, but maybe that'll change, and maybe this video stuff will take off more rapidly.
Yeah, I think regardless of, I'll use Tom as an example. I think regardless of whether you're trying to promote your own business, your own operation, I think Tom does a pretty good job of engaging people. He likes to post questions and see kind of what other guys are doing and what's working and what isn't working. And to me, I think that's pretty key. Just to have the ability when you say a tweet, for example, you're posting a tweet as opposed to just saying, hey, you know, I do this, and trying to get some people to follow you, do something where you can actually engage certain people that are out there and you know, even for lack of a better term, begin to build some type of a potential relationship. And I think he would probably tell you that his business has maybe even grown a little bit and developed some relationships just because of his presence on Twitter and engaging people.
Right. But one of the things about Twitter is it's so temporal. I mean, it's really short-term kind of a system. So trying to figure out how to capture useful information, because you'd want to, like in this case, John's recording this so that it'll be useful later, which is a nice way to do it. So you don't just have this conversation once, and it's just the 10 of us having the conversation. It gets magnified to the population. And Twitter's kind of an interesting one. It's so fast. It's hard to tell how it will really dial in to decision-making processes. I guess that's my concern.
Yeah. Yeah, it's hard to hold a long-term conversation on Twitter, for sure.
Yeah, people ask me, well, where do you put the most information? Well, in terms of quantity of posts or updates or anything. And, you know, it seems to me like the areas you put the most work into are blogs, you know, the actual stories. And you can't spend 5 hours a day writing stories all the time. So, you know, maybe you spend a half hour or an hour or whatever it takes to build a good quality post for your blog. And you do that once a week. You know, maybe you can keep up with it once a week. The more the better, I think, in the standpoint of maybe a couple a week. But then after that, then on Facebook, that's where you supplement with, you have a Facebook page, you supplement with photos and other things that maybe aren't appropriate to have, you know, on a blog post. And then after that, you push that to Twitter, and then you start talking about those pictures on Twitter. You know, Facebook is not really about having a conversation. You can in the instant message and stuff. And maybe with the new tweaks they're going to do to Facebook on the timeline, you can start to have a little bit more conversation. But it seems like important stuff you spend the most time on, you have the less quantity of them. And then you get to Twitter, and it's just like a free-for-all where everyone's talking. And I don't mind if I miss people and chats on Twitter. If I miss it, big deal. It's not that critical. If somebody responds directly to me, then you know you continue that conversation. But to me, it's like when I pull my phone open, when I'm sitting at the traffic light, and I catch three or four tweets. If they're interesting, I might either retweet them or comment on them, and then I move on. But there's always kind of a conversation that's going on over the course of the day and weeks and months, and that was really the way we started the tweet up at GIS. We just took some people that were talking to each other on Twitter and Facebook and all the social media and said, let's get together. And I think that's one of the misconceptions, and maybe the next thing to talk about is that social media is impersonal and you're not meeting people. And actually, it's the opposite, I think. When we met a lot of people at the GIS tweet up, I didn't have to ask them where they were from and what they did and, you know, anything about them. I already knew it because we had been having discussions online for a year. And so immediately the conversation started at a much higher level than had I just ran into them on the trade show floor. So. Bill, you were going to say something?
Tom, I was going to say, Tom just responded on Twitter. He appreciates everybody's input, and he says it's definitely enhanced his business relationships. So just to add to that from his point.
He also messaged me directly and said that there's feedback and echo, so we still have some issues to work out with on the live stream. I think the recorded version that we put up, it won't be an issue, but maybe what's going over the live stream right now, it's a little bit echo. Anybody else have any comments? Mike, are you here? We see a silhouette of him. He's got a new haircut, too. So we've kind of gone over.
Now I see a book cover.
A book cover? I don't know what I see. So we've gone over kind of some of the uses, and I think that Twitter, Facebook, and blogs have been pretty much the most common that people are using. Is there anything else anybody's using that would have that social aspect? I use Foursquare and Gowalla and some of the location-based services. And actually, even for turf diseases, they have a new area where you can start a page on Foursquare for a business or whatever you have. And I started it on Foursquare and posted updates from all the FedEx Cup tournaments. So if people check in, it'll be like a to-do, and it'll be like, spot some disease at this tournament and check in via us. And Foursquare has been something that I use occasionally, and I like it because it's a tracking system for me. But when I started posting those updates on Foursquare via Turf Diseases, all of a sudden we had all these people following Turf Diseases, and I think they're up to like 45 or 50, which for Foursquare for us is pretty good. And so I think we're reaching out to a much larger group, maybe people that golf, maybe people that have no idea about agronomy and turf. So it has been able to maybe share our message with a larger audience.
Yeah. Hey, John, what when you say you use Foursquare as a method of tracking, what do you mean by that? I recently got on Foursquare probably maybe a month or two ago and just kind of used it randomly. But what do you mean by tracking, just to kind of go back and follow through what kind of things you've done? Or I guess I'm not quite following you there.
Yeah, for instance, there was a big meeting in France a couple years ago, and I was visiting cafes and museums and doing stuff, and every time I would go, I would check in. You know, you're having a glass of wine at six different cafes. You never remember where you were and what the places were and what the names were. And so I was checking in, associating a picture with it. I also use Gowalla, which is another system very similar. I like that it tracks, like, my flights, and I can see what countries I've been to. And so every time I go to a new state or a new country, I earn a badge that's from that country or that state. And so then I can say, oh, wow, this is where I've been this year. And to me, it's more of a nice way to visualize some of the places you've been and to try to remember some of the things that you'd never remember when you go to a new city.
You know, to kind of elaborate on the previous question, I don't know that there will be more platform development, because if you look out there, and I could be wrong, but you've kind of got the niche in every social media area. You've got your Facebooks, you've got your Foursquares, your Twitter, you got your Flickr. So you're kind of covering your bases. But where I think you're going to see expansion, and I think it's really going to be beneficial to superintendents, is when these developers with the mobile devices, and whether it's the Android operating system or the iOS operating system, you're going to be able to start doing these types of interactions on your mobile device. I know Google Plus right now, you could actually join or start a hangout on your Android phone. iOS will be soon, where you'll be able to do this on your iPhone. You know, for guys like John or Larry, that'll expand, and Jason as well, that'll just expand your network. Because, and sorry guys to put this on you, but I could start a hangout with John or Larry and say, hey, I'm out here, I'm seeing this kind of damage, and just kind of turn my phone around. And, you know, they're not going to be able to possibly not diagnose it 100%, but at least I get some more input, you know, or maybe it's not with guys like John or Larry in the education sector, but maybe it's with another superintendent. Maybe it's, hey, you know, I'm looking at the irrigation system, you know, and you flip your phone around, you're showing your pump station. I think that's where this type of software is really going to expand for us and just give us a lot more capability.
Well, I think that, following up on that too, is that it would be really interesting if you could somehow use Foursquare for everybody to check in when they're on a site that's for the various diseases. So everybody just got, well, the people who have gut problems at a specific time, if everybody would know where that is, and you could talk to each other about it, or focus more directly on what's going on in those particular regions. It seemed like it'd be an interesting way to get that information out and to study how the epidemics are moving or whatever.
Yeah, I would say that one of the most effective ways to try to get people to get a benefit out of social media, and not just social media, but I check my email regularly, but not all the time. And so when the email comes in, to me, it's the important information. It's the business important information. But I'm always on social media stuff. And so we try to, with the Turf Disease Facebook page, we try to say, hey, if you have a problem, upload a picture. And somebody that's on here, there's, you know, almost 2,000 followers and a lot of pathologists from all around the world. Somebody on here probably can give you an idea if the picture is clear enough and the, you know, disease is obvious enough. And somebody can give you some insight in terms of what to do. And that feedback could be you standing out in the field. By the time you get back to the shop, you've got an answer of what potentially it might be. I think that that's been a great way to use it, and a way that I think most superintendents who fight the social media, I don't want to use it, I don't want to do it, I think that's one of the things that they're missing out on. So,
yeah, well, I think the trick is going to be able to get is trying to encourage people to want to share on that kind of a level. And a lot of people are nervous and don't want to share their problems. I think that's going to be one of the main hindrances to getting photographs of stuff up on the web.
Yeah, that's a concern that we definitely have. I think, you know, you get into some of the courses that are high profile and maybe a little bit more reserved in what they're going to share. You're not going to get them doing it. You have to wait. You have to wait until somebody in Golf World posts an article about problems top courses are having. I'm sure that guy doesn't know what the hell he's talking about either. But so I think ultimately there will be so much information out there that posting a disease problem, a real problem you're having at your golf course, is not going to be a big deal. And you're going to probably get more feedback and more help by putting it out there than trying to hide it. So, I don't know. There'll always be some of the clubs that don't want that out there, but I think there's a lot that are using it effectively.
Well, I think some of the problems also, because this medium tends to last, outlive the conversation, or at least recorded conversations would, when people are talking about what they did, and if they've made a mistake somewhere along the line, it's going to be interesting how it's handled, who will be critical, and how that information will hopefully not come back to bite somebody. But it's one of those kinds of concerns I would have in it.
Yeah, I would agree. I don't think you want to go air all your dirty laundry, but you know, sending the right information, limited information, but to the right people may be something that can be beneficial. Jason, back to you. Are you getting people fighting you on what you're trying to do? Or are you getting good feedback from your clientele down there about the use of social media, or people who are not using it?
The people that have engaged on, primarily through Facebook, is where I've seen some engagement with the industry. And actually, I was thinking about it as we were sitting here talking. Most of that engagement has been from the golf course industry. For my research program, I try to engage more of the sports turf side of the industry. And I've seen guys like John Mascaro and a couple other people that are, you know, hit or miss with Facebook. But most of it has been, interestingly, from my observation in Florida, you know, the golf guys. But no, in terms of resistance, I don't think that there's resistance to it. I think that there's a steep learning curve that people have been maybe, you know, dipping their toes into slowly and trying to figure out how they're going to use it. I think that any guidance that, you know, just like the people that are around the table here today, any guidance that we can provide through outreach in terms of appropriate ways of using it to these people that are newcomers will be viewed as being very beneficial. So I think that's something that will help out quite a bit and probably speed the acceptance of social media use.
Right. Sorry. People keep coming. So what do you think, and I'm sure it's going to explode, but what does everybody expect to see? We have a few minutes left here. At some of the this is conference season. We're starting, you know, I think OTF and the Carolina show's coming up, and then GIS and the Canadian show. I saw kind of like a premature explosion of all the social media stuff at GIS last year, probably when most people weren't ready for it. But I anticipate it's going to be even bigger this year. What's everybody thinking about in terms of what they're going to get out of social media? I know a lot of you are speaking on social media at GIS in particular, and I'm giving several seminars at different places as well. Anybody have any thoughts on
it? I'm looking forward, again, to more of the app development. I'm kind of comfortable with the social media platforms I use. I don't really see myself expanding too much more. I think some of the platforms that are out there kind of overlap each other. But as these applications come out, you know, and you can utilize iPads and iPhones more to do a lot of this, that's where I see myself going. I said before last week, I think at GIS, I think there's a lot of potential there to integrate mobile devices and social media as well. And I'm hoping to see that expanded. I know they just announced the GIS app for the iPhone will be released shortly. I asked if there were going to be any changes. I haven't heard anything yet, but you know, I think GIS, I think there'll be the same type of presentations. I think there'll be a lot more activity this year. Moving forward, I'm looking forward to being able to do things like this on mobile devices.
Yeah, I think actually the Google Hangouts now, if you have an Android, which I know, Bill, you're an iPhone user, but if you have an Android that has a front camera, now the Google Hangouts, you can actually participate in them with the Android. So that's pretty
Yeah, cool. You can. As of Tuesday when it went public, you can go on a Hangout.
You can start one from an iOS device, but I don't know if you can join one yet.
You guys want to give some plugs in terms of what you're going to be talking about at GIS, those of you who are doing social media stuff?
I teach a 4-hour seminar. I think it's Tuesday morning, 8 o'clock, Take Control of Your Career with Carol Rao. Carol kind of touches on resume, cover letter, portfolio building, and I press heavily upon the use of social media to promote yourself. I'm also doing some tech on the half. They've got Answers on the Hour and Tech on the Half. I'm doing iPad uses for superintendents. I'm doing Bento for superintendents on the iPad and the computer. I'm also doing how to utilize cloud storage. With a lot of these mobile devices now, you can essentially have your files and your documents on the kit. So that'll be discussed as well. So, and check out, make sure you check out the Tech Lab this year. I'm working with the IT department with GCSAA, and going to be a lot of really cool stuff in the test drive Tech Lab this year. Make sure you check it out.
Yeah, we'll have to obviously pull out a few of the tech things that you think are good for turf managers, and maybe making them a more concentrated discussion in one of the future episodes that we have here as well. And you want to mention your website too, Bill?
Oh yeah, Bob and I, we kind of work together with the iturfapps.com. With the summer, our primary jobs are making sure we stay employed as superintendents. But hopefully that picks up again soon, and iturfapps.com. So check it out. And guys, I got a roll here in a minute or two, but it was good seeing everyone, and look forward to more of these.
Okay, thanks, Bill. Bob.
I'm doing a couple of talks at GIS. Just participating in the What the Tech session. Just basically like a 20 or 25 minute little talk on maybe 4 or 5 apps that I use or that superintendents could use. And then also I'm Tech on the Hour or on the half hour doing a talk about Evernote. Just how I use it and how turf industry or a business could use it in general, even a city or anyone, on how to use that. So yeah, and the iTurf app stuff, and like Bill said too, I'm very interested in the development side now. I'm going to spend a good part of this winter kind of looking into some ideas I have and maybe trying to develop some stuff, or at least learn how to develop stuff. So
Bob, when you're talking about developing stuff, are you going to try to find someone that's going to help you do it? Are you going to sit and learn code, or what's your overall plan?
I think I'm going to try. Well, I had already started the enrollment process to go to school. It was one of our local Rasmussen colleges. They have a new program that started up this year, and it was due to start in October. And I kind of looked at the curriculum, and they're a for-profit university, so there's a lot of stuff that I didn't really need. But there's so much stuff online now that I think I'm lucky in my position that I literally don't have to come into work the entire winter, so I can stay at home and do stuff. And I'm going to really try and dive into as much online stuff as I can find. There's some tutorial sites you can subscribe to that will walk you through kind of the steps, so I'm really going to dive into that. I'm looking at some FileMaker stuff right now. FileMaker just released their iOS kit to help develop like a FileMaker database that will help link, you know, back to a main database. So stuff like that I'm going to really try and concentrate on this winter.
Nice. Greg? You're muted, I think, Greg.
There, is that better? Sorry. I will not be talking about any social media at GIS, but I'm certainly planning on participating in both of those guys' classes that they're going to be doing. I think, like I said, I'm still relatively new to all this, at least within the last year, and want to speed up the learning curve a little bit faster than what it is, and certainly wintertime is a good time for me to do that as well. Okay.
Jason, I assume you'll do you go to GIS as well as STMA, or do you stick with one or the other?
I end up getting away for a couple weeks and go to both. So, okay. Actually speaking at both conferences this year, and I'm not talking about social media at GIS though. I'll be talking about fertility management. So, okay,
Larry, making the long trip to Vegas.
Yeah, I'm probably not going to go to GIS. I'd be at the STMA. Because that's close, but not probably going to be at the GCSA show this year.
Okay.
Well, hopefully I run into you, Larry.
All right, yeah.
And Nadim, I don't think that you have a mic or a phone, but thanks for joining us here. I'll wrap it up. I'm going to be at GIS, obviously. I can't ever make it to STMA because my classes start, and you're already missing a week of an eight-week program. and so it's really tough to get away, but I will be at GIS, not talking social media, but talking more turf disease and turf management stuff, which is what I really get paid for around here. So that's probably what I should be focusing on. But I want to thank everybody for showing up here this morning, and we'll see how the recording looks and hopefully continue to do this on a semi-regular basis and have some good topics to discuss. I'll try to post some links and some additional information for people on the blog once I put this video up, and that's it. So anybody else have any last minute words?
Nope. I'm off to kill some more grubs.
Do you do that by hand and just squash them, or do you actually have to All right, everybody, thank you very much. I appreciate it.
All right,
and we'll see you all next time.
Thanks, John.
Thank you.
Okay.
Hey, John, quick question for you.
Yes. We're still recording, by the way.
Okay. Where do you see the value of clout within? Do you see a value within the turf industry, or is it just something that people kind of latch on to and do what they can?
It's a good question from Greg. Sorry, I didn't have the camera up on you. It's a good question. I don't know. I try to read what people are saying about clout, and apparently a lot of the companies are actually utilizing that information and those rankings as being, you know, a way for them to get some metrics on users. It seems like clout just released some new additions to the site, so they're trying to expand. I still don't know the best way or the right way or the most effective way to kind of rank how people are. Right now, it's a numbers game. You know, if you're a celebrity and you've got 2 million followers, that's a pretty big audience on Twitter to send a message out to. And Penn State has a philanthropy called Dance Marathon at Thon on Twitter. Shout out to them. They're the largest student-run philanthropy, and they make about, I don't know, $8 million a year, something like that. And when they started getting Kim Kardashian mentioning things about Thon, I think it kind of brought a mainstream awareness to a pretty good cause and a good organization. And so there's definitely some benefits to having people with numbers that will repost some of your stuff. But as far as clout goes, I think they're still figuring it out. It's one of the only ones out there, so that's what people are using. But I don't know. What's your feeling on it, Greg?
I haven't really used it with any great seriousness. I think it's a good way to kind of track what other guys are talking about and who's influential about what. Some guys are a little more serious about it than others. But I do find it interesting, and I can certainly see the benefit to companies or organizations being able to track who's doing what and who's saying what about any particular thing. And you know, if you look at some of the perks that they have available, it gives you an idea on really where they're trying to head with this thing. And you know, through people just mentioning certain specific things in tweets, you know, who knows where it could lead. you know, I don't think it's a game. I think there's really a lot of seriousness involved with it, and I think there's certainly a lot of room to grow from it. I just don't. It's hard for me to grasp right now where I should take it for my own personal use.
Yeah, I guess from an egotistical standpoint, we all want followers and we all want some clout or some kind of, you know, recognition for what we do. I really was interested in that early on, and now I don't get as worried about it, I guess. I just want to make sure that we have the interaction and that social aspect of the social media. And if people think that it's useful and they get it, great. If not, then they don't have to follow it. But my goal is to get as many people as possible interested in using it, whether I rank high in clout or low or have 20 followers versus 2,000, is becoming less of an issue for me. In fact, I'm thinking right now, I almost did it this morning. I'm thinking of deleting all my Facebook friends, clearing it out to zero, except for maybe my wife. And
good thought.
and start rebuilding with people that, you know, are really my true friends. Now with some of the features they have on Facebook, like subscribe, I can get information people want to make public, and I don't have to be friends with them. I'm hesitant because there are some relationships that I built with people that I wasn't really friends with, but because of Facebook, now we know each other. So I'm hesitant, but it may be a good exercise to do anyway. So,
well, I did that about a year ago, and you know, when Facebook first came out and you started using it, it was a game to see how many followers you could have, and you end up taking these people that you haven't spoken with in 15 years or you've never met or whatever, just to increase your follower list. And I had enough, you know, people trying that I just didn't have any relationship with whatsoever, wanting to have these conversations or making comments or posting things, and it had enough, and I just wiped it out clean and then started scratch with people that I actually currently talk with or use it as a platform here at work to have memberships involved. Our club has a Facebook page, and so I've got my page as part of that, and I didn't see any negative feedback from it whatsoever.
Yeah, it's actually a good topic for a future Google Hangout. We'll mix some social media in, and primarily we'll be talking about diseases and stuff, but with all the social media stuff, I thought this was a good topic. But even something as simple as like how to most effectively use Twitter. I have 1,600 followers or something on Twitter, and the stream goes very quick, and so I can't keep up with it all the time. So then I create lists and I watch those lists. So if I want to see what's happening with turfgrass, I just look at my turfgrass list. And there's ways to not miss everything when you do have a lot of followers. But having a lot of followers has become less and less important to me, because I don't have a business. I'm a person trying to get information out there.
Yeah, I just don't use Facebook that much anymore, I'll be honest. I'll link blog posts to it, or you know, do something here and there, or four squares with it. But I find myself leaning more towards Google Plus now as a more professional end, and we'll certainly dive farther into it as we get into the winter and I have more time to mess around with it. But for me, Google Plus is easier to use for the little amount of time I've spent on it.
Yeah, I think that they have some functions that are obviously better. I'm really excited about Facebook's timeline that I just got today. So I'll play around with that, but we could keep going on forever, but we're a little over an hour. I'm going to end this. Thank everybody for coming, and thank everybody in the room, Jason, Greg, Larry, Nadim, and everybody else that dropped out earlier, Fidanza and everybody. So we'll do this again in the future, and hopefully the recording turns out all right. I'll see you guys at a later time.
Have a good weekend.
All right, thanks, guys.
Bye, John. Bye.